We're going to start a series of filmmakers sharing their own experience, and it will be introduced by a fantastic keynote of two people. And we are going to have here sound designer, filmmaker, and disability rights activist Jim LeBrecht, who is the co-director of the 2020 award-winning documentary Crip Camp, which is, by the way, executively produced by Barack and Michelle Obama. And Jim is also a co-founder of FWD Doc, an organization that supports documentary filmmakers with disabilities. And we have also Nicole Newnham, who is an Emmy-winning documentary filmmaker, producer, and writer with an experience of 25 years, I think. And she's a co-director also of Crip Camp. So we are totally happy to have you two with us. The screen will be yours in a second, but first we want to see the trailer of Crip Camp. Thank you.
Wait, you want me to tell them what happened? Well, two people got cramps and they're sweating.
We were all very hyper about it. And I have to go shower some people. I'll see you later.
I wanted to be part of the world, but I didn't see anyone like me in it.
I hear about a summer camp for the handicapped run by hippies. Somebody said you probably will smoke dope with the counselors, and I'm like, sign me up.
Up to Camp Jeanette and find yourself.
There I was in Woodstock.
You wouldn't be picked to be on the team back home, but at Jeanette, you had to go up the bat.
Even when we were that young, we helped empower each other. It was allowing us to recognize that the status quo is not what it needed to be.
The world always wants us dead. We live with that reality.
At the time, so many kids just like me were being sent to institutions. It was just a continual struggle.
Most disabled people, like myself, are unable to use public transportation.
We needed a civil rights law of our own.
The rehabilitation program has been vetoed by the president because it was cost prohibitive.
We decided we were going to have a demonstration.
You get the call to action, to the barricades.
A small army of the handicapped have occupied this building for the past 11 days.
So many people from Camp Jeanette found their way into the building.
The FBI cut off the phones. The deaf people went, we know what to do. That's how we communicated to the people outside the building. The Black Panther Party would bring a hot meal. We were like this.
We are the strongest political force in this country.
We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.
What we saw at that camp was that our lives could be better.
You don't demand what you believe in for yourself. You're not gonna get it.
I search for pleasure.
Do you like to see handicapped people depicted as people?
Excuse me?
Wait, you want me to tell them what happened?
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Nicole Newnham. I'm the co-director of Crip Camp. I thought that I would just start out with an image description of myself. I'm a middle-aged white woman with blondish brownish hair down to my shoulders, red glasses, and a blue shirt, sitting in front of a bookcase in my house in Oakland, California.
And hi, everyone. I'm Jim LeBrecht. I'm a little bit beyond middle-aged white guy with black glasses and a gray beard and mustache. And behind me is a red wall with some posters behind it.
Jim and I have just returned from the Academy Awards, which was an intense experience. And so we've been thinking a lot about sort of the narrative of our film from conception to that moment on Sunday. And we've been asked to speak about the question, who has the power to speak and who gives the power? And so we thought we would tell you a little bit about our journey and the time that we have together. And it seems like the best place to start that is with the idea as it occurred to Jim and his desire to tell a story.
I've had the really great pleasure to have worked with Nicole for about 20 years, but not as a filmmaker, but as their sound mixer and sound designer on three of her previous feature-length documentaries. So I'm a sound mixer and designer working in the San Francisco Bay Area. I've worked on probably about 200 documentaries. I really have seen the power of documentary film. And although I had seen some films around disability, I knew that there were a lot of other stories out there that should be told, could be told. And I took Nicole, about 6 years ago, I took Nicole out to lunch and I pitched her some ideas about films that maybe that she would make. But actually kind of offhandedly near the end of our lunch, I said, I've always wanted to see a film about my summer camp. I said, I think there's a really incredible story there about these people who go from New York out to Berkeley, California, and that there's a connection to the disabled civil rights movement. And I said, and, you know, this is a camp for folks with disabilities run by hippies.
So I was extremely excited by this idea because the image Jim painted for me of a kind of egalitarian utopia where young people with disabilities and hippies were kind of free-ranging it around in you know, the full throat of the late 60s and early 1970s, and really part of a revolutionary way of thinking and a revolutionary movement at the time, I realized was blowing apart so many stereotypes of the way that we typically see people with disabilities on screen. And also, Jim had been my friend and an activist in around disability representation in the media for many years. And so I was excited about collaborating with him. He sent me these pictures of the camp. We became obsessed with trying to figure out how could we recreate the camp. We didn't have access to the footage at that point, but we were kind of on fire about it. But I kept thinking, is this my story to tell? And how am I going to tell this story? And what is really, truly at the core of why I feel this project is exciting? And the answer I came back with was Jim. You know, this is Jim's story. He was a part of it. He's been in the filmmaking community for decades. He is poised to tell this story from his own point of view. And my model for the kind of film that I thought could be powerful was The Times of Harvey Milk, which is a documentary I've long admired, partially because it feels so much like you're getting to witness a community telling its story from the inside out and to each other. And so I went back to Jim and said, I don't think that you should produce this and I should direct it. I think we should co-direct it together. And that really, I think, was the most kind of critical linchpin in what ended up becoming Crip Camp. And I don't think that we fully appreciated at the time exactly how revolutionary that was. But I think what we needed to then do is build. We needed to raise money. We needed to get allies. We needed to make people in the industry sort of share our vision for telling this revolutionary story in a way that it had never been told before. And then we started realizing that even in the process of developing the film, finding the money, finding the partners, and conceiving of it, we were going to have to be activists, you know, kind of claiming that right to tell that story from that point of view and literally knocking down physical barriers that were in our way because of lack of access in our own industry. Wouldn't you say, Jim?
I would say so. I mean, what we realized very early on is that there were places that Nicole could go that I could not because I use a wheelchair, and that this impediment was going to be an issue, you know, for us. And, you know, how can we try to change this? And so, you know, for instance, you know, we went to the Sundance Edit Lab, but, you know, this place was not very wheelchair accessible, but they made accommodations. But they also had to wind up building some ramps, which they did, which was really, really wonderful. But, you know, one of the bigger issues that I had been trying to fight against for years was the fact that the Filmmakers Lodge was up three flights of stairs in Park City, Utah for the Sundance Film Festival. And, as we were working along, we finally were able to reach top people at Sundance and said, you know, this needs to change, you know, and they pivoted as well as they could and as quickly as they could. And by the time that we appeared at Sundance, we premiered at Sundance 2020, there had been an elevator put into the building. And it was quite the moment. It was really quite the moment. So we've really wound up being this, as Nicole calls it, kind of an icebreaker in the industry. Our working with Netflix was an incredible experience in that we basically entreated them or asked them to really be activists along with us. That, yes, this title, Crip Camp, is... you know, it's we use the word Crip as a way to reclaim the word cripple, and that this is a real indication of that our film is not just a sweet little portrait of this summer camp, but that there is a cultural connection, a civil rights connection, and it even came down to, you know, how do we display captions or you know, with folks that some people might find hard to understand, how do these words appear on the screen? In the long run, our film is accessible to more people with disabilities than any other film they had done before. More languages for audio description, more languages for captioning for the deaf and hard of hearing. And we got a request that they make a script so that people who are deafblind can go to the website and download it and be able to load it into their Braille readers so they could also experience the film. And Netflix was never hesitated and really, really supported this mission.
Yes, it was really important to us that we bring in our major partners like Higher Ground and Netflix, our executive producer, Howard Gertler. As we built out our team, every single one of them had to be allies. And I would say that Jim was incredibly visionary and had a lot of forethought around even things like making sure that when our budgets got approved, our budgets had line items in them for screenings that would have closed captioning and be accessible to people across a variety of disabilities in the community so we could share our cuts with people in the community. And for us, I think a huge piece of making a film that actually could be held by and used by and shared by and loved by the community, including the second generation of activists who are working now, was that we needed to share it with them as we were working on it and get their feedback. And one thing that we heard from young activists was that this was going to be a seminal film on disability culture. And it was, you know, but they weren't seen in it because it's a story from history. And so we started to think a lot about how could we kind of disrupt the power dynamic that often happens when a film comes out into the world and sort of film people are holding the keys to a film that really belongs to a community if it's a movement story. And so we we ended up making the decision to partner with a couple of young activists from the disability justice movement, which centers the voices and leadership of people who've been traditionally marginalized within the disability community as part of their principles. And they created this incredible impact campaign during the pandemic that was a virtual summer camp that ran for 16 weeks and created this massive community of 10,000, mostly young people with disabilities, many of them like young queer disabled people and people of color within the community. And they used the launching point of the film and its platform to build capacity for their movement in the middle of a pandemic. And we wanted to show a clip of that summer camp experience.
Welcome back, Crip campers, and a huge hello to President Barack Obama.
Hello, everybody, and hello, Andrea. I was hoping to see if there were going to be any s'mores. I guess virtually that's hard to do. One of the first films that we were lucky enough to be able to produce was Crip Camp.
Scenes from Camp Jeanette.
It was so moving to us to see all these young people, teenagers at Camp Jeanette who left camp believing they could lead a worldwide movement, finding their voice and awakening to their power.
Andrea Levant.
Bringing the Crip Camp story to life means so much to our community.
What I want to do is hear from you about what camp's been like.
You have joined us on our sixth week of Crip Camp.
Hi, everyone.
We're continuing the work you see in the film with leaders of today's movement.
Always like to start with a spirit of gratitude.
We have over 8,500 people registered to join us for camp each week from all over the world.
People using sign language.
Making sure everyone feels included is our priority. This includes folks who are deaf and hard of hearing.
Image description, okay.
And blind and low vision.
A dress with a black top.
I have heart-shaped glasses. Short curly hair.
I'm wearing a denim shirt. There's a picture of me swimming in Hawaii, which is where I was born. My hair is much grayer than it was just a few years ago.
President Obama, I think that there's somebody that you wanted to bring in as well.
Somebody who has helped to make unbelievable change in this country and around the world, and who just happens to have been featured in Crip Camp.
We want no more segregation.
How are you, Judy?
Judy Heumann.
Welcome, Mr. President. How are you?
How do you see the relationship between activism and protest and social movements and government?
We learned very early on that we needed to learn how laws were made, how they're implemented, how to work with our city government, our school boards. We would never have been successful if it wasn't for coalitions.
Historic footage.
Section 504 has led to sweeping changes in transportation, healthcare, education, and job opportunities.
I can't imagine a more important story to tell. Our greatest progress has always come from the ground up.
Scenes of protest.
That's how the 504 sit-ins happened. That's how the ADA happened.
The passage of this monumental legislation will make it clear that our government will no longer allow the largest minority group in the United States to be denied equal opportunity.
I was proud to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the ADA at the White House 10 years ago. Now, as we celebrate the 30th anniversary, we have to remember the hard work and sacrifice it took to win those battles, so it gives us courage for the battles that remain.
1990 Capitol crawl.
Right now, when we're in the middle of a pandemic, at a time when people around the country are waking up to the systemic racism that so often has excluded people, Crip Camp with film and the work that all of you are doing reminds us that when people get involved and they recognize their own power, they can achieve extraordinary change.
You can join the Crip Camp virtual experience at cripcamp.com. Netflix.
So that virtual experience, I think, is symbolic of what we've tried to do, which is make the film with the community, bring the film out into the world with the community. And every step along the way, try to use the experience of bringing the film out on a major platform to empower the community and to break down the structural barriers that that are still so much in place in our industry. And I think we just wanted to, you know, before we say goodbye, we wanted to talk a little bit about what that was like, the effort that Jim made in particular. And this is really symbolic of, I think, the incredible advocacy and leadership with which Jim brought to this entire enterprise around the breakthrough that occurred, even if it wasn't noticed as much as we would have hoped, at the Academy Awards last weekend.
Our entourage was an extraordinary group of people. Judy Heumann was with us, and Andrea Levant and her service dog. And imagine on the red carpet, three people in power wheelchairs and a service dog. And that our presence there at the Academy Awards was very much noticed. And in fact, this was the most accessible Academy Awards ceremony ever. There was a ramp to the stage. And we entreated the Academy to really make this a very equitable experience, where everybody in a wheelchair was traveling exactly the same path as anybody else who didn't have a mobility device. And we felt incredibly welcomed. And this truly did feel like a real incredible breakthrough. What can I say?
We're running out of time here.
I don't know what that had to be.
But it is amazing. I mean, I think we talk so much in our industry about the power of story, and I think we are still experiencing a sense of awe and wonder around the fact that we watched a story like literally break down structural barriers in front of us, and I think that's because of so many of the shifts in power dynamics that we pushed for throughout the process of making the film. So thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Jim and Nicole, this was really great. Thank you so much. And I already learned something, and I want also to say something, that we have had a hard time to find a sign language translator in the last days. We would have loved to have one with us. They were all completely booked in Copenhagen here to join me in the studio, and I would like to apologize for this. If we have any sign language translator listening to me right now, or even watching us right now, please reach out to the festival so that they have you on the radar for next year. Thank you very much. And I take the opportunity to say to everybody, I am AC. I'm a white, androgyn-looking, non-binary curator and host with short brown hair, wearing a black suit and a white shirt in a studio which is all blue, white, and black with paper. It is a beautiful studio, and I hope you will see this in your spirit then.